but I will certainly confirm to you whether or not they contributed to it. In relation to the extra care, I think your point was that there is some extra care for autism and will there be more for learning disability. What we want is to give a range, an increased range of accommodation with care options for people. I fully appreciate we are talking about people in the majority here who have significant needs and will continue to have significant needs. I would draw a distinction between the all-age disability strategy that's for everybody in Wirral who has a disability, and our general approach is we need to increase independence for people with disabilities. When I'm talking about commissioning of services for integrated commissioning arrangements in my report, that is for people with significant means that we fund through social care and through health provision. So we recognise that these people are people that are less independent and will be more dependent on support. But even so, we still have a need to increase our range of support offer for those people. We have a high number of people with learning disabilities living in small, shared, supported living properties. And we do get the odd occasion where people have needs that aren't compatible, or their age related needs aren't compatible, or so on. And our intention would be to give more people the option of living in their own home with the support on site.
But sorry, how do you then tie that in with exploration of more regional approaches to provision of care and support to people with a disability?
So that relates to some discussions we're having on the Liverpool City region. We've done some market analysis across all of our market providers, our care providers, and which local authorities are commissioning with those providers, and looking at the volume of people that are supported. And we think there's opportunity for further discussion on a regional basis, and to look at exploring options for ensuring good quality standards of care, looking at market sustainability to make sure that we haven't got a disproportionate amount of support from one provider, perhaps, where there would be concerns that if that provider went under, it would be a significant risk for the system. So the opportunity is there to have oversight across the and a wider footprint to make sure that we've got more sustainability within the market. That's what that is relating to.
Thank you, Jamie.
I was reading the CQC reports. That's part of this report and the next report you're going to do. And I noticed there was a lot of the care providers going into inadequate, red. I think Alan sent them across to them. I was really disturbed that, this is why I want a view to the front line of what's going on the front line, what's going on right now in our care homes across the world. And this care home was inadequate in every single category, including safety. And there was another care home that was also inadequate on safety as well, and near enough on every other category also. And, I don't want to really go into the report because it was quite upsetting. But the thing that was said in the report was that it's only by chance that somebody hasn't received significant harm because of the way you're looked after by this particular provider. So what have we got in place to prevent that happening right now? Because these people were supposed to be being cared for. And the staff that have been taken on by this provider, talking about 11 of the Care Act. So this is the whole thing we're talking about, joint commission and all these buzzwords everyone's using. This is what's going on the front line right now. So I want to know what's in place to prevent that happening right now. Because we've got a pledge that people in older life should live well. And for me, they're not only not living well, it was a criminal neglect. Because this provider had actually taken staff on without giving them a DBS check. You've taken staff on without training them. You gave the staff workloads that they could not cope with. So they knew by giving them staff them workloads that they couldn't get around to see them patients in the time frame that them patients were expected to go and see them. And this wasn't a care home, this was the delivery to people living in their own houses. And these were vulnerable adults with dementia and other complicated, complex needs. And I just couldn't believe what I was reading.
Do you want to pick that up, Jason?
Yeah, thank you. Yes, there are a number of care providers in Wirral that are rated as inadequate or requires improvement, and that's in the majority across some of the care home providers. As we know, the care providers that we commission with our independent organisations, in order to place vulnerable people with them, we have assured ourselves that they are registered to provide the care and that they meet safety and practice standards. Now, it is the responsibility of those provider companies, organisations, care homes to continue to provide the good services and to adequately train their staff and to keep up with their requirements for their registered status and regulations. Where they do fall short of standards and where we know they are inadequate or require improvement, we have a joint local authority and CCG team of quality improvement staff, quality improvement officers from social care and health backgrounds that actually work with homes to help improve standards. It's usually the case where we are aware of a home that requires improvement or is inadequate, that there'll be an agreed improvement plan in place. There'll be announced visits from the quality improvement team, and we need to see progress of improvement against the areas of improvement in the improvement plan. There are occasions where providers fail and they fail to reach the standards. And in those cases, our primary concern is for the vulnerable people that are placed there. And we have mechanisms in place to respond in those eventualities. And where people are agreeable to move from a care provider, where it's continuously failing, we will offer that option. And there are times if we're faced with a home closure or with the Care Quality Commission serving notice on registration of the provider, we will work in collaboration with the CCG, work with the provider and company owner to work out the best thing for the residents within that home. People that are a priority are people who don't have capacity due to dementia or other related illnesses, and we will always make sure that we put their safety first. So we have a team that focuses their energies on improving standards in the care sector, and that's care homes and domiciliary care providers. But we have to remember that the domiciliary care providers and care homes are not provided directly by the council, and we have to work with the Care Quality Commission and the providers to make sure that standards are maintained.
Just a follow up on that. I mean, this report, you know, it was criminal, it was premeditated. Lack of care, you know. They take it on the staff without DPS checks.
Tony, would you mind if I just came?
Of course.
Because we had a conversation about this, didn't we? I mean, this one in particular was domiciliary care, and then the other one that we were talking about was residential care home. I think the concern that we've got, and I don't know if we all feel this way around the table, but the time lag between the CQC reports and us actually receiving them, council and our NHS partners have actually already, you know, dealt with the situation. I mean, domiciliary care, as we know, has heard back that they're now out of business, and quite rightly so as well. And monitoring the council and our NHS partners are monitoring the residential care home. I think, and I know in particular, Councillor Rennie has, like me, it's been a hobby of us. And we mentioned this when I first took over as chair last year, and we haven't actually got to really delve into some of these reports that we're getting, and I'm really, really concerned, as I know are many of the members around this table. So I think that in the new municipal year, this needs to be one of our first things, and whether we set up a task and finish group, whether we set up a separate panel, so that we can actually question some of these care homes and care providers, because I really think that's what's needed. I don't want to see something in the world blown and hear about it that way. I think it's what we all say, the mum test, isn't it, or the dad test, and that's where we have to come from. So I agree totally with what you're saying, Tony, and I thank you for raising that, because I think you really need to do something about it. But, you know, if we can put that first on the agenda for the new year. I've got Tony next, and then I've got Wendy, mixed up now. I've got Wendy next, and I can see Phil.
Chair, actually, one of the things I was going to ask has been covered, so I'll keep it brevity as possible.
Thank you.
It's the same for me.
Right. Anybody else?
We'll block your problems. Just what you were saying, Chair, and what Tony was saying, I mean, agree more with. And I think, I mean, it's great to have our partners from health and other organisations, but I think we need, as you suggest, perhaps a task and finish group or something. Need to get these care providers here in front of us. Not just those who we feel are obviously inadequate and not performing, but all of them, you know, really a good cross section, because we don't have anybody on this panel either representing the residential care sector, do we? And I think that's something we might look at, but you know, in sort of the remit of true scrutiny, we should be having these people before us. I mean, we would if we were a parliamentary select committee on the smaller than that, but as far as we're just concerned, this is the equivalent, really, because these people are not questioning
that.
I think we need to be, you know, tough on this, because otherwise we're going to be looking at Facebook and you see some of these dreadful things that are going on, and, you know, videos of people in residential care. And it really is worrying on the time scale that you talk about. Just one night of that type of behaviour is one night too much, and that time between the CQC reports,
it's too long.
It's far too long. You know, 24 hours is too long. I know we can't prevent everything, but you know, it's I think you know, it's the human race, isn't it, for a citizen, that's the way to handle. I think we need to at least assure ourselves and feel comfortable that we have people in.
I'm going to take Phil next, and then Christina, and if that's it, we'll move on to the next part.
Thank you, Chair. I want to go back to paragraph 3.7, and that's because I don't know how we get from here to the new exemplar buildings.
Yeah.
We have this description of small or more traditional supported living houses. I can think of houses that have been converted, or bungalows that are run by particular organisations. No comment on the property converted well and the people having in there, but it's a unit of a certain size. The report suggests that we'll be approaching organisations and saying to them, actually want to build somewhere more like a little community. And I haven't got a picture of the size of what's thought of as being, so I say, economical, or where supported living cost is spread over more people, but it still works, and there's still enough people there to care individually and to answer the calls or the alarms or the fact that people want to be from a number of us did go to Hollow Ash Road. So I've got a picture of the size of the unit as particularly respectful, certainly. from those houses dotted around in various places to units of a certain size, which you can't yet envisage. Nice if we had an architect who keeps seeing these pictures from the growth company and things in certain publications which give artists impressions of things. We could actually do with an impression of what we're talking about. Because I've no idea what one might cost. Primary school costs us $4 million, modest size one. So presumably a unit of this size might cost $750,000 to $1 million. I've no idea, I can't put an idea of what I'm talking about, asking people to move into it. I have an idea of what we had in the past. Christine will probably remember Silverdale as it was.
Absolutely.
Which struck me when I read this report, reinventing the wheel, that we're going back to having places of a certain size and scale that are a community and which are welcoming, which people enjoy living together and have all the services. So if we've got a plan for a number as unspecified, you need to think about sites, you need to think how capital or supporting living budget is adjusted to achieve this and a timeline. Sorry to be a bit pedantic, but I think I said this about other things. If we have a vision of where we want to get to, we need the talks with the providers taking place to see. We'll talk about individual people with individual lives in the community, and homes where they're happy. We're trying to change things for them, or help them, or around them. But you want, I can imagine if somebody went to a firm X, I'm sorry, firm X, provider X, and said, you've got a unit of only 4 or 5, it's not very economical. We really think the people in your unit should go into this new super duper accommodation as a group, and we'll bring another group from somewhere else, and we'll love you to all gel together and enjoy life in the future. And we'll see how we get from here to there.
Yeah, thank you. It's a difficult, there's no single answer to that. It's a difficult one to respond to in a short time. The Joint Commissioning Plan will detail a range of different schemes that are either planned or in discussion stages. It largely depends on the site, the provider, the registered housing provider, because most of these arrangements are through social landlords, registered housing providers that will typically finance the build, and people will have rents, income to pay to the housing provider, and the care will be provided by a different organisation that would be typically commissioned by the council and or jointly through integrated commissioning units. So there's no single answer, but we're not talking about large schemes, we're not talking about equivalents to large care homes for older people. We're talking about small schemes. I don't want to be quoted on it or help to it, but you know, about 8 to 14, 15, that kind of size. So it's where you've got some economies of scale in terms of the care provision being on site and being able to be shared across a number of people, but where you've got good accommodation for people with their own apartments, their own front doors, and not having to share in a smaller house that may not be fit for purpose. There are supported living establishments that we've got vacancies in that we've held for a long time that we've found it difficult to find people that will benefit from that accommodation. So we do need to look at this in tandem with looking at our existing supported living arrangements. So I don't know if that's any help in terms of an answer, but there's no single answer I can give on that, I'm afraid.
Thank you.
Just to take
a
last question from Christine.
I want to support what Leslie said and what you said about the review. What worries me is the CQC things that come through. We're talking about, we're now in March and we're talking about June. People could be experiencing some very valuable things in 3 months. And I think that we need to be able to set up what we're going to do so we actually are doing it in June as opposed to setting it up in June. And I think we could do that with the spokes alone could manage that, the basic guys. It's too important to let go. I'm concerned that there are people who are going to have been to these places and seen this, and surely they've reported it, because I know people have. At a home very close to Ridge, Leslie will realise what I'm talking about. But it doesn't seem to tie in with inspections, because everything's so disjointed whichever way you look at it. So I would ask that we get we get the groundwork done, the skeleton done. And then going back to what Phil said, I think Phil and I had raised eyebrows there, because we were told this lovely place at Silverdale, which we pushed to get built, and we'd been in the old house before that, and all the money had gone into Silverdale, and then we're told, no, people don't like all living independently with their own front door in a group thing. They like being in a home. You wouldn't like to live on your own, would you, with your own front door? No, I wouldn't, I thought. You'd like to live in a family, well, that's what we're doing. So, yet again, we are telling people what we think is best for them with another model. And I don't know what drives people, whether it's just that they like change or I don't know what. But we've been here, we've heard it all now, haven't we? It's going round and round and round.
Thank you, Christine. Can I just pick up on the first part of what you said? And it's obviously difficult because we're going into Verdun now. However, I have already spoken with Alan, our scrutiny officer, and Graham Hodgkinson, and we've looked at, can we have a database where it actually shows us a RAG rating so we can see straight off which are the care providers that we need to be looking at and targeting, in a certain order. And I think that perhaps if we can organise a meeting between spokespeople, and then we can look at how we can attack this, really, so that we've got everything in place ready. If that's okay with Wendy. So,
can I just give you a note of caution, though, on that thing, is what I used to expect. Something can appear to be fine at one inspection, so it's going along okay. The next inspection, it's down.
Yeah. Yeah.
So looking at a RAG rating of where they are and where they've been isn't always helpful, because it might lead you to believe that some are okay, and then the time comes when they're not.
Well, perhaps we can look at previous reports and the current report, so that we've got something to compare, and
well,
we can see whether there's a trend.
Staff and a change,
change
needs.
Of manager. Yeah.
Got to change.
I agree.
Yeah.
Unless it's the same.
Yes, it is, Julie. I'm just going to say, the health watch will already have on spot their checks. Perhaps you need to tie in with them.
Can I just ask it of this group how many people have considered signing up as interim view councillors, because so there's quite a few of us. I'll talk to Karen Pryor as well. I'll go through. Thank you.
Can I just pick up
just
on
once, and that's it, then I need to move on.
Just on that point that you just mentioned, entering the year, I signed up to it along with a lot of other councillors probably 18 months ago. I've been to two care homes within that time, and you were very restricted on the questions you could ask or where you could actually go. I didn't find that it was that comprehensive myself. I think that we need to be clear.
Okay. I mean, I found that I asked all the questions I wanted to ask. I'll talk to Karen at Health Watch, and we'll have a look at reviewing that again. Does that answer all parts of your question? Yeah, okay, great, thank you. We'll move on then. And we've now got Vaughan Hayes and Suzanne. Thank you for waiting all this time, Suzanne. Did you want to come up to the front door? Have you given us a bird on the floor?
I'll just invite the colleagues as well. Thank you. bedded unit and supports 22 service users. And it was with much regret that we had to take that decision, but we'd experienced a number of challenges in ensuring that we could sustain safe staffing. Just to give you a bit of background, in terms of Thorne Hayes and the context behind that, Thorne Hayes is registered with CQC and has regulated activity which requires us to have a registered nurse on site 24/7. And this is despite some of the service users who access Thorne Hayes actually requiring 24/7 nursing care. And over the past 18 months, there's been a lot of debate and uncertainty around the model of care going forward for respite services. The national agenda talks very clearly about short breaks and where that moves away from health respite to more person-centred individual provision. And I think, you know, part of the challenge that we've had is the staff have been living with that uncertainty and have sought opportunities elsewhere when they've been presented with those. So we found ourselves in February with a challenge around not being able to fill the vacancies following staff leaving and a real challenge about being able to source any what we call temporary staffing or agency staff to fill those. And we've gone through a number of options looking at what we could do. We spoke to other providers within the rural economy to see if they could help us. We also looked internally within the trust to see whether we had the staff with the specific skills that we could move across. And at that point in time, it was felt that it wasn't able to be able to do that. So we've been working very closely with the families and service users who've been accessing Thorne Hayes, working with the local authority, looking at what alternative provision we've been able to offer them during this period of suspension. We are pleased to say that we have been able to offer all families an alternative. Understandably, some of those families didn't want to accept that alternative for a variety of reasons. And I think it's worth saying that families are very connected to Thorne Hayes. They really like the building and they've got some good relationships with the staff. So there was some real hesitancy around sending their loved ones to another provider who they didn't know. There were some families that did accept alternative provision, and the remaining staff